We are ready to talk about the future here. We've talked about the past, we've talked about the present, and now we have a high school student, a college student, a younger academic, and someone who's been here for many years, ready to talk about their visions for the future. So we're going to start with our presentation. Obviously, all the bios are in the back here, so please read them. All very interesting people, interesting work. We're going to start with Luwei, who is a senior at Francis Lewis High School, and Mitch Wu, who is a person working with her. They're going to come up and talk about the project that they're working on.
Yeah, and I think we could just sit here.
Oh, they're going to just sit here.
That's fine.
Okay.
We don't have a PowerPoint or anything like that.
Okay.
All right. Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, Mitch. Hi. It's okay. So my name is Mitchel. I am a program manager at the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families. We are the nation's only, that we know of, Pan-Asian Children and Families Rights Organization. Been around since 1986, so that seems like a common year, you know, that 30th-year anniversary for that Cornell Summit as well. But our organization has been around for 30 years as well. And we are a policy advocacy organization, which also runs a particular leadership program focused on low-income recent immigrants. We have it for families, so it's for young people in high school and also for parents. I manage this program. This program has been around for 12 years. And you know, I could talk a little bit about it, but you know, when AAARI actually invited me to speak today about the particulars of leadership program and contemporary New York City urban dynamics, you know, I felt like, you know, well, you know, I could talk about it, but it's better to have young people speak on it. So I'm just going to do a little bit of introduction to the program, and then I'll let Luwei talk more about her experience in the program, her experience, you know, as a young person involved in community campaigns and advocacy and leadership, and also kind of the impact that it had on her. So the program is actually called the Asian American Student Advocacy Project. So the short acronym for it is called ASAP. This program has been around for 12 years, and so at CACF, you know, as we do policy advocacy work, our belief is also we're not only advocating on behalf of the community, but we also advocate with the community. In that sense, you know, that's where we really wanted to, you know, have people that are really impacted mostly by issues, be the folks there at the tables when we're talking to key decision makers about how to make, you know, better, you know, funding resources, how to make better policy, see how to allocate, you know, better services for these specific targeted audiences. Now, I guess the last thing I would just add to that is, you know, I also have, I touched on this conference in 2 points. I am, you know, I'm also teach Asian American Studies at CUNY Hunter. I've been there for a couple of years now, and I want to kind of take. Bring back that point that was mentioned earlier in a lot of the previous kind of panels. And it's kind of that core and essence and heart of what Asian American Studies is supposed to be and how that ties back to, you know, the community praxis and knowing what the community needs are because it's actually birthed from the community. You know, just a side note, like, you know, even when I'm teaching my class, my final is actually an optional final, and that's, you know, I've been teaching for 8 years, and I've had this policy for the past 8 years in my classroom, where you could come in and take an in-class exam, or you go out in the community, volunteer or participate with an Asian American grassroots serving organization, and then write, you know, a final project paper on this. So you can really, you know, see kind of like, you know, kind of the, you know, historical concepts and as well as the theories that we study in the classroom and how that ties into current contemporary relevancy. That being said, you know, we also tie in a lot of those components into our youth leadership program that the one that Luwei is in, and so you know, really understanding the history, right? You know, how to make those connections and how you can feel empowered by that kind of information. So that being said, I'd like to introduce Luwei Xiong, who is currently a senior now at Francis Lewis High School, a public high school located in Fresh Meadows, Queens.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Luwei, and I moved to this country about 3 years ago with my mom. And when I first came to my school, Francis Lewis High School, a public school composed of over 50% Asian Americans, I felt kind of overwhelmed by the resources and the, just the new environment I was in. So I also feel kind of disconnected to this community I'm in because I feel I, at that time I feel I was sort of like a foreigner. So soon after after my first freshman year, I participate in Asian American Student Advocacy Project, ASAP, which Mitch mentioned before. And ASAP is really a nonprofit student leadership advocacy program for students, for immigrant students like me. And as a recent immigrant, when I first joined the program, I learned a lot about APA history and APA culture, including APA literatures, and some historical facts, like the first APA came here as early as 15th century, which I never learned in my school. And I, in that sense, I feel like I'm part of the history or the part of the society. And I also realized my experience in my high school is it's actually a very large issue in my community. Because when I first came here, my guidance counselor really saw me as a model minority because she believes I can just take whatever classes. She never thought I need any kind of support. And when in ASAP, I met students from all around the city sharing the similar experience and backgrounds. I found out not only me, but really it's the community facing the issues, including like guidance counselor problems in public schools. So last year we had a campaign, it's called Campaign Bridge, to improve the guidance counselor system in public schools. And I personally testified in a few citywide council hearings, including English language learner students hearings and school budget hearings. And from those hearings, I tested my own sharing my own experience and also propose our recommendations to the city council. And actually last year we just passed a bill on collecting the citywide guidance council data from all around the public schools. And not only really I help out with the community issue, I also benefit from the program a lot. Like I develop my teamwork skills, public speaking skills, communication skills. I have become more and more confident to represent, to advocate for myself and my community. So I took more challenging classes in my high school. I'm just have developed the skills for college readiness and for the skills in real world. And the impact of ASAP is really to help out the immigrant students in our community. And I hope ASAP can be, our voice can be heard by more people and more young people can join our program. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I have for today, yeah. Thank you guys. Thank you.
Hi, so I'm Emily. I'm from Cornell University, and I'm part of Asian Pacific Americans for Action, which is the kind of activist advocacy arm of the API community on our campus. So that's why I have this little slide at the beginning that just gives you a rundown on what APAA is, which is Asian Pacific Americans for Action. When I saw that the title of this panel was The Future Is Now, Leadership, Students, and Communities, I thought about this phrase, the future is now. It's very, get a sense of urgency. And I think that sense of urgency is related to a sort of militancy that you used to see in activism, especially on Cornell's campus. So I wanted to kind of go through the past of the creation of the Asian American Studies program at Cornell, because a lot of it has to do with student activism and student militancy specifically. So all of this begins with 1969, the Willard Street Hall takeover, which was an incident on Cornell's campus where a burning cross was put on the lawn of the a house where black women would live. So then a bunch of black students took over this main student hub, and they used guns to take over this hall and to demand that Africana Studies be established, for there to be housing, a safe space for black students. So this is what fueled a lot of race-related activism on Cornell's campus. That leads to 1973, where what's called the New Coalition is a group of students who are all pushed for ethnic studies. So this includes Native American studies, Chicano studies, Asian American studies, Africana studies. And this is really powerful. This is the first time you see a bunch of students with different identities joining together to push for ethnic studies on Cornell's campus. This later leads to 1985, what's known as the First World Alliance, which I think is a weird name, but that's what it is. It's the same idea of you have different groups. You have black students, Asian American students, Asian students, Chicano students, Latinx students, Native American students joining together to fight for ethnic studies. Yeah. And then this leads to 1986, which a lot of you know, a lot of you were there, which was a conference on ethnic studies on Cornell's campus. This is, I think, is the Asian American Studies conference, right? And this is what leads eventually to 1987, where Asian American Studies, the program is created at Cornell with Lee C. Lee as the director. So you're probably wondering, why did I go over this timeline with you on how Asian American Studies program, this specific program at Cornell, was created? But the reason is, when you say the future is now, I don't think you can really think of future imaginations of what you want for Asian American Studies without looking to the past, allowing the past to inform the future. So specifically, I want to talk about activism, student activism, and how I think it's changed, and how I think it can be wielded in the future to actually push for Asian American Studies, to kind of mobilize people to make Asian American Studies something that's a standard, and especially at Cornell, to make it a major in a department to allow faculty to be retained, which is our current problems. So first, starting with activism, in the past, there's a lot of militancy, and I think that militancy has deteriorated. Nowadays, activism has become professionalized, so it's now a mere performance instead of it being about the actual struggles, and I think it's lost its radical roots, which is really important. I also think in the past there was a lot of power in coalitions, and when I say coalitions, I mean interracial coalitions, and I think that's that's powerful information that I think can be wielded for the future. So especially on Cornell's campus, you see with activism now, different groups, Native American groups, Asian American groups, black student groups, and then Latinx community, were trying to fix the fractures within what's known as people of color, to try to join together, create this coalition, and fight for ethnic studies. Especially since on Cornell's campus, ethnic studies is in danger of being collapsed and for funding to be cut. Those are my two main points. Otherwise, regarding the panel's topic of the future is now, I think beyond thinking of how students can play a really strong leadership role in furthering Asian American Studies, I think it's important to look at what students want from Asian American Studies. So I think Vijay Prashad posed to me recently, what do I think is the next breakthrough in Asian American Studies? What's the future of Asian American Studies? He thinks Asian American Studies as we know it is dead, has run out of gas. And I agree with that. My answer was, I think Asian American Studies needs to be pushed more towards questioning nationalism and questioning this idea of the nation state. This isn't just Asian American Studies anymore. This is something that's transnational. I think it's time to look at greater structures such as nationalism that are producing othering and other systemic forms of racism. So that's my talk.
Before Joyce talks, I just want to say, Emily's talk reminded me that Cornell was the epicenter of East Coast Asian American Studies for many years. I never realized the backstory there, but all of us are beneficiaries of the actions that people took at Cornell. It's a perfect example of how, no matter where you are, do something because it will have consequences for everyone else. Do the right thing, and in this case, the Cornelians got this thing going, and Anita Affelt, whose name is on the travel scholarship for graduate students, she was working under Gary Okahiro for many years at Cornell and helped many of us with our travel arrangements, and so we are the beneficiaries of what you and your predecessors at Cornell did. So it's very important, no matter where you are, keep on doing something good, and it will affect everyone else. So thank you.
This is a very hard act to follow, because you see some progression here, obviously, and I've been at it for a while now.
The best is last.
Oh, thank you for that. I don't know if I mentioned earlier that Rockwell Chin and I actually co-taught a course at Cornell in 1990 and 1991. That was a very long time ago, and I realized that some of the folks on the panel might not even have been born at that time. But in terms of the future, I started off this conference with saying that Asians today are not who Asians were when Asian American studies really came to being. In addition to that, when you have all of these technologies and other ways of communicating layered against all the things that are happening, the pace at which things are happening, it really makes the field feel quite complex. And the interdisciplinary nature of Asian American studies itself also makes it extremely complex. But it still comes down ultimately to people. And it comes down to us being connected, and whether that connection is through word of mouth, convenings such as the ones that happened at Cornell and earlier, or whether it is through our publications and so on, it boils down to people and communications, and we have to find a way to keep that going. Today's Asian Americans, a good portion of them are foreign born. Again, they do not have the underpinnings of, as was mentioned earlier, the idea of the Civil War, of reconstruction of the civil rights era, and so forth. And these things are extremely important because it frames what has happened to us. There was a mention earlier on about bringing Chinese in particular to offset the fact that blacks were refusing to work without being paid when slavery ended. And in fact, Asians were also brought in to counter the white labor movement in the North as well. So we've always been pitted against other folks. And those are issues that continue, and it doesn't stop, because somebody mentioned that we're fighting for the same resources. So this is all to say that the history of the past still has a major influence on what's happening now. It's imperative that our young people learn about this history and that the newcomers learn about this history. There also seems to be a division between the newcomers and the American-born, for example. And part of that is because, again, lack of communication. Many of the American-born young people no longer speak the language of their families. And then the newcomers have not acculturated and feel that comfortable with English sometimes. I had a student from University of Maryland actually say to me that she has started a blog where she and her friends, who are foreign students, they're international students, are writing for an audience in China, telling them that when they get here, that they need to get to know their Asian American counterparts, that Asian American counterparts are tremendous bridges for them, and that communication has to start somewhere. So again, there are a lot of these issues. Time is running very quickly also. Generations used to be 30 years. Then it became 10 years. The difference between people who are 10 years apart in age are tremendous. Now it's 5 years and maybe even three. When I look at my own children, they are 5 years apart in school. One identifies as Chinese American, the other identifies as Asian American. Because the identity formulation is different, the number of Asian students in their cohorts were different, and so on. One has greater Chinese language facility than the other. And again, that age difference is the reason. The older one negotiated all the issues in Chinese with grandparents, so the younger one didn't have to. The older one translated for the younger one, essentially. So I see those huge differences within my own family. And then you add grandchildren on top of that. And so now I see my grandchildren don't speak any Chinese at all. And I see that from a personal point of view as a loss, because so much of your culture and so on are captured in the language, right? Somebody mentioned the importance of relationships. Who you are is in the context of your family. In Chinese, for example, I don't have to say that I am the third youngest sister. Just the way that you call me tells somebody immediately that you're the third youngest sister. I don't have to say all of those words to describe who I am. So language also is a lens. It gives you a perception or a perspective on things that you don't have when you don't have that language. I'm sure a lot of you have had the experience of getting yelled at by your mother in the family's native language, and that's a heck of a lot more painful than being yelled at in English. So those are the kinds of things that I think are happening. And from the point of view of my generation, and again, this is personal, and this may sound a little simple, but our generation has a duty to connect with the younger generation, to learn from the younger generation, to understand what it is the younger generation is facing, and to give guidance where guidance may be appropriate, where we may have stories to tell that may give a younger generation solutions. We don't only have to educate the younger generation, we also have to talk to the parents of the younger generation. I can't tell you how many issues I've encountered between parents and children because there's tremendous misunderstanding. The communications are almost like this. And that's what happens. I talked to a group of Asian parents about how they needed to talk to their children. I grew up in a household where I came home with a report card once where I had 100 in every subject except for physical education. My father would not sign the report card. I grew up thinking I was never good enough. And I realized many, many years later that my father thought I was really good, and that was his way of pushing me to work even harder. But it didn't have that effect. It, in fact, really affected my thinking about myself and my capabilities and so on. So when I tell parents this story, I tell them, look, I know that when you talk to your children, you usually get to the things that are wrong or the things that need to be addressed. And so your child only gets a negative perspective. You need to start the conversation by saying, I know you're working hard. I know you're doing good work. But mom only has a short time with you. Let's address the things that we might do better. And I had actually Chinese mothers sitting in the room tearing up and coming up to me and saying, that's why their children don't talk to them. That's why their children run into their room when they come home. It is because they've become a negative force. Every time they encountered their child, it was, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong. And there was no relationship there. So again, if the future is now, then it's our duty to try to interface with the younger generation and with the people who parent them to try to smooth the way. And also to help them understand the culture in which their lives are taking place, the context in which the things that happen to them are happening.
OK. Okay, so we're ready for some questions. First, I just want to say congratulations to Luwei and to Mitchel. We have a comparable program at the University of Maryland where we have students who've learned Asian American history teach Asian American history to high school students. It's called the Yurikochiyama program. And every year, the students come through for 10 weeks. Every Saturday, they get together. I take them on a tour of Chinatown. You know, we do different things to get them interested in Asian American history. And I can tell you, Luwei is already on a very good path. She's gonna obviously have a very good career no matter what she does. But I think the experience we've had in doing that for a couple of years, it really supercharges the students. It gives them that confidence and allows them to feel leadership possibilities. I mean, it's very clear you have them and they're gonna get better. And for Mitchel, thank you very much. I mean, you've obviously had a good impact here, and I'm sure you're going to have it on a lot more other students over the years as well. Let's give them another round of applause. So does the panel want to say anything about others? Emily, did you want to add anything? Or Joyce, you want any comments on your peers' presentations, or are ready to go out to?
Actually, I want to add my own definition of leadership. So I used to think leadership means you have to be at a very senior level to give other commands. But from my experience in ASAP, I realized leadership really means just taking the initiative and then voicing for you, for yourself and for others. Because I am first an advocate for myself, for my own education, and then I'm the advocate for others, for my community. So you could really do leadership, present your own leadership skills at whatever level you are. Yeah, that's my thinking on leadership.
Yeah. I wish somebody had told me that when I was her age.
Okay, so do we have any comments from the audience? Come to the microphone, sir. What's your name, please? Here.
My name is Russell. I work for Joyce and the organization.
So obviously, you can't say what's really on your mind. That's your.
Oh yeah.
Believe me, he does.
No, I'll make it clean. I had a question, Emily, because I know Vijay as well, Prashad, about Asian American studies being dead. You, it may be dead, but it may be like the snake that sheds its skin. And, you know, a month later, it has a new kind of skin, a new kind of coloration. So I was wondering whether you could maybe talk a little bit about what do you mean by dead, not alive, or maybe dead in its old form? Or I was just kind of curious what you meant, because it seems that from hearing a lot of the panelists like yourself, it's actually is a, and from some of the work that Shirley is doing, for instance, Asian American Studies is actually far from dead, but actually playing a different kind of role, maybe, or in a different kind of skin.
Yeah, I don't think Asian American Studies is dead. I'm not sure if anything can really die per se. I agree with what you're saying with it's like a snake shedding its skin. I think it's more of Asian American Studies as we've always known it, especially from the starting from the 60s with SFSU and the strikes and ethnic studies being born. I think how we have taught it, or maybe how we've learned it or seen it, has changed a lot. And I think Vijay, in his context, he meant it more as he thinks it's gassed out. So he thinks that it's like future imaginations. He doesn't think there is quite, I think maybe he was saying like there isn't as quite the imaginations that in the past Asian American studies would provoke are no longer there because we've already like searched through those imaginations. So I think it's more like what's the next breakthrough? So it kind of relates to what you're talking about, what kind of role does Asian American studies play? And that's why I think, for me personally, I think Asian American studies, it's not dead, but I do think the students need to push and think more critically about Asian American studies. So like, what even is America? Like, what is Americanness? Does America encapsulate the Caribbean? Does it encapsulate South America? And like, what is Americanness? Like, why are we so quick to claim Asian Americanness when we're put under this umbrella of API and Pacific Islanders technically don't see themselves as American? So I think these are the questions that we're trying to provoke from this like from the statement that Asian American studies is dead or like Asian American studies has gassed out?
No. Thank you. I agree with you. I just wanted to mention that about 20 years ago, Shirley Hune, myself, and a number of people, we actually did put out many publications on Asians in the Americas, and we covered, you know, Latin America and people like Evelyn Hudi Hart. Many, many people actually have Henry Yu in Canada is doing work on North, what he calls the sort of the North Americas, in which he's looking at the relationship of indigenous peoples and Asian Americans. So I think there are actually people that are doing work on looking at, trying to debunk the old theories and ideas around American exceptionalism and actually looking at the Americas and, in fact, you know, the world through new vantage points. Thank you.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Asian American studies in some ways has really evolved, particularly because of the global connections that we have. It used to take months and months to travel from an Asian country to the United States or from Europe to the United States. Now it's a matter of hours. It's a matter of getting on Skype or Google Hangout, if you can get Google in the other country and so forth. And so the connectivity between the land of origin and the United States is very strong, and it continues to be very strong and has a tremendous influence. I think, too, that with the rise of China and the rise of India, there is less of a desire, perhaps, to shed that identity and to become, quote-unquote, American. Because, again, no longer is China looked at, for example, as the sick man of Asia, which is how I learned about China. It's enough to make you reject your identity if you're exposed to that enough. And so again, things are changing. I do want to tell you that the first time I ever saw a picture of Mao Zedong was in the centerfold of a Black Panther paper. And that shows you the extent to which we were taught about Asia, at least in my generation.
I just add one thing to that. I think in terms of kind of describing how it's quote unquote dead, where it hits road bumps, where there's actually kind of like roadblocks or dead ends. I've heard some academics casually kind of, kind of articulate their frustrations about that, right? In terms of connecting to, you know, the audience, in terms of feeling that, you know, maybe the actual content of the curricula is a little outdated and so forth. And I think it kind of goes back to the piece that we were kind of talking about earlier about cultural competency, in terms of really understanding the audience and also the community that you're working with. And so it is that evolution. I think that's the topic that a lot of us have been talking about, right? In terms of like understanding kind of all these particular conceptions of identity when it comes to, you know, region, space, national identity, you know, international identity, and also the different kind of ethnicities, right, and the different narratives they bring, which for me personally, I feel like that's also one of the good things about the discipline of Asian American studies, because it is so interdisciplinary that it could actually tackle that. And so we just have to be very mindful of that piece about cultural competency and all the different diverse and vastness of the diversity that we're, in terms of the communities that we're talking about.
Well, first of all, I know it's a long day, so.
No, I'm good, got it, yeah.
I want to thank this panel, especially the younger generation. The question I have, actually Emily and I haven't talked, and Emily and I are supposed to chat about Cornell. First of all, I think we need to acknowledge the role of the students, but also the role of Lee C. Lee. And I don't want to kind of speak any negative about Anita, but it's really Lee C. Lee who spearheaded that. You know, the dynamics of academia, you need a real partner in a tenured faculty member who's really dogged. And you also need students, and you need strategy. The question I have is, you know, now in 2016, we have a very large and growing and more diverse Asian Pacific population. We have a growing number of Asian Pacific American elected officials, although not as many as we'd like. but at least a growing awareness of the need for that. And we have a fairly vibrant number of Asian American Studies programs on the West Coast, certainly reflecting poorly on the East Coast, but certainly we shouldn't neglect the histories of Cornell and other schools. So it seems to me that this presents a challenge, not just for academia, but for the Asian American, Asian Pacific American community, in terms of finding ways to have more resources, not just 25,000 or whatever. You know, somebody said, oh, 25,000, that's a pretty good donation, but how about 25 million? Not just from alumni, but I mean, we really need to reach higher, it seems to me. And you know, sometimes we just go little bit by little bit, but it seems to me that we're in a great challenging situation, but also a crisis, because if we don't step up, and this requires more than just academia, it requires community, it requires elected officials, it requires political power and allies. If we don't step up, we're also facing this year, this tremendous backlash of and tolerance for hate speech, I would say, you know, by a candidate, really call it for what it is, which is shocking when you think 2016, you know, if things were pretty shocking after 9/11 in terms of all the anti-Muslim actions that took place, but this is 2016, so I would just throw it out to all of the younger generation and, of course, Ari, but perhaps following up some of the things that Ari has done, the question that came out earlier was, is there a way that we can strategize a little bit more? Not just among the academics. I hate to say it, but I think sometimes academics can get too esoteric. It's fine to have debates and discussions and so forth, but you know, you slice and dice what is Asian American, you know, I mean, come on. Part of this is just understanding the world. You know, having a body of academics and researchers who will help us understand the world better so that we're smarter when we implement policies and so forth. So maybe thinking going forward, since you're young people, and maybe Joyce can comment too, you know, what would you like to see like a year from now? You know, 1986 when Lisi Lee pulled that together, that's a long time ago, but you know, we can start to think of what are our benchmarks and where do we want to be like a year from now?
So I'm going to want to hear from the young people, but I will say to you that if you come up with an idea, I will find some resources to try to help get that done. So that's the challenge. It's my generation's responsibility to come up with the resources. If we're in the offices that make some of these decisions and have some influence, then it's our duty to support the young thinkers or the thought leaders that are coming up.
I just want to say, as somebody who's been doing this for several decades, the key is to have audacity. Audacity is the single most important characteristic you can have as an activist, because you have to think outside the box. Just looking at Rocky there, he's somebody who wrote in the first issue of the AAARI-CUNY Journal, he did a study of Chinatown that was there in volume one, number one. He was there in Bridge Magazine, a number of these early publications. In fact, one of my favorite publications Rocky wrote was called What Happens After Volume One, Number One, because it wasn't clear when these publications started whether there would be a Volume One, Number Two. So you have to be audacious. You have to step out and try something. Obviously, you've got people like Joyce who can give you the resources. You've got someone like Mitch who can be a mentor, to what Luwei is doing. Emily's part of a great tradition at Cornell, but we've all got to reach out to each other, network with each other, mentor each other if possible. But Rocky's challenge is very, very important. We have to think about what is coming out of this. We as academics, you know, we are going to get paid, we have our jobs, but what is going to happen tomorrow and next year? I mean, that's an important question. I see Bob Lee is coming, and I want to just acknowledge Bob, who's been one of our community historians for many years. When I teach my Asian American art class, I refer to a lot of the things that Bob has compiled on his website. It's called artspiral.org, and the Asian American Arts Group. Let's have a hand for Bob and what he and his wife Eleanor have done for many years. You know, being in the community, I remember getting these letters saying, hey, our resource center for dancing and for art and stuff is having financial problems because gentrification comes in. And you know, it's hard to keep an institution going. So when you see someone like Bob who's persevered outside of the academy, but doing just as much as any academic in terms of preserving our culture, it's really very inspiring to me. So thank you, Bob.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now I don't have to say a lot. I, like Joyce said, I have an obligation, I have a duty. I have to tell people about art because unfortunately so many of these Asian American studies over the years has not included what artists have done in the United States, and what I focused on is artists from 1945 to the present. And so before I get into just mentioning two, because I already mentioned one, artist that you might begin to start there, because you can see 160 on my website, 10% of the total amount of artists in our archive. I was at the Rubin Museum, and I heard a talk by a physicist who had just finished his book, and he published it, and it was proving that time and space exists, even though quantum physics shows that there is no such thing as time. And he introduced his talk and his book in terms of that this was his purpose, this is what he was after, to show that time, linear time, exists in the theories of the mathematics of quantum physics. He didn't start off, you know, perhaps like some scientists, where you don't know what you're going to end up with as a conclusion. He knew where his conclusion was going to go. That's what he was doing. He wanted to establish Western values as proven by science. If time exists, then there's linear time. Then there's progress. Then there's, at a certain point in Western history, eugenics and the improvement of life and getting us all better human beings. With Hillary and Clinton actually participated in one of those experiments, early eugenics experiments. We just saw a film of a lovely girl wondering what her life was about. And I think that an Asian point of view on this is to say from the other angle of physics that we know only 3% of what's in the universe. 97% of physics don't know what the hell the rest of the universe is made of. The rest of the universe is unknown. We start with mystery. The horizon that we face, the future of whatever we're going to study, or whatever we're going to call it, is this vast thing we don't know. And maybe we want to begin with the way perhaps Asia has looked at life, and that is to accept it, not to improve it, just let it be what it is. So with that, I'll tell you that I saw a talk, you were there, I think, with George Takei, and he was telling us, please go see Allegiance. Please, we can get through the winter, we have a chance to get an award. If that we get an award, we may last for 2 or 3 years. And this was at a conference at NYU dealing with Islamophobia. How can we fight Islamophobia? Not just know about it, not just collect information about it. How can we resist? How can we fight? And he said, here's Allegiance. Here it is, right on Broadway. We could have this in front of the public. But all the producers, he said, no. That Asian Americans don't support the arts. There was very little hope that Asian Americans were going to make up through that winter the ability for that play to go on. And sure enough, it closed. And so I was telling them that that's my point. Something that we have so powerful in front of people and we don't have arts in Asian American studies, and we don't have arts in front of our people to raise the funds to make it continue. So,
Excuse me, Bob, we've got 4 minutes, so.
So I will mention in 4 minutes, one artist.
Well, oh, no, we got each of these people gets 1 minute, so you got about one more minute.
1 minute, Lily Ye. She's got 6 doctorates, honorary doctorates. She's challenged the nature of arts and brought 2 African tribes together over the reliquary of bones caused by the massacre of people. She has changed art in terms of what its effectiveness can do. Why don't you know about Lily Yao?
Okay, thank you, Bob. Okay, 1 minute, please, and then.
Thank you, Dr. Nash. And I'm very proud. I joined the Mitchell's group about 2 years ago, and I mentioned to him, I said, this is the future of Chinatown. Today, I'm glad I see them, especially I saw the Cornell the achievement, so I'm very happy about this. I'm trying to say about, I was very motivated by Joyce mentioning about parent-child communication. I myself, as a psychotherapist, as a mental health consultant for Head Start Chinatown. I have a mother's group. I teach the mother the parent-child communication and the democracy in the family. And especially three important time for parent-child communication. One is after school. The mother should ask the child what's going on to the school. So the child learn to speak. Then the mother, meanwhile, learned what's going on in school. So the mother know what's going on in school, so mutual communication, number one. Number two, during the meal time, so they can relax the family, what's going on. The third time, the bedtime, to tell story. Because if the mother, father tell the child story, they feel being good mother and a good father, and to give love to the child, to intensify the parent-child relation. The whole day parents work, didn't see the child, and the child didn't see the mother. So the fourth one is the weekend, the father show up to see the child participation. So the family participation emphasize the mother, father has to participate in the community activities, volunteer, participation, vote, and the family activities. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Wu, and thank you for your years of civil rights work as well.
I want to mention 2 things this week, a counterpoint to what you mentioned about Asian American studies being dead. Both of these developments have happened in California just this week. On Monday, California State University Fresno announced that they will unveil a Hmong minor this fall. It will be the 5th in a nation after 4 other programs in Minnesota and Wisconsin. Also, San Francisco State University, they reached an agreement with their with hunger strikers regarding ethnic studies. And they will develop a program in Pacific Islander studies, as well as getting 2 full-time tenure track faculty appointments in African studies. And I just wanted, these are happening in California. What is California doing that the East Coast isn't doing?
They got tired of the east of California, so now they want to be sort of the California of California.
What are the takeaways that campuses on the, I mean, again, for me, the East Coast, West Coast thing, that's a phenomenon that is new to me. So what are the takeaways that campuses here can take from their California counterparts?
We got to keep it short. We have actually one more comment. So
yeah.
1 minute. Yep.
Okay. I'll try to keep it really short then. I mean, I was I also come from an immigrant background. My family immigrated here also in 1986, straight to Queens, New York City, and I grew up, you know, became very kind of just conscious about a lot of these issues. So, which led me to do my research and actually got my master's in comparative ethnic studies at SF State campus. And so I guess, you know, and I was kind of like along that type of thinking trajectory, thinking, okay, well, wow, all that stuff was going on out there, and they have that history, and they have that culture, and that space, right, and that identity. How can I bring that here? Or how can I be trained out there to bring that back here? And I mean, there are some elements, you know, that, you know, in terms of some of the progress that they had out there in terms of just, you know, community dynamics, you know, political power, right, elected officials, something that Rocky mentioned earlier. But to sum up, I would say, you know, in terms of the curriculum and departments and colleges of having ethnic studies, Asian American studies, that is something that is always in contention. That is something that people always have to fight for. And whether you're on the East Coast or West Coast, you know, the hunger strike you mentioned, it was a hunger strike because it was a budget cut. It was a heavy budget cut to SF State. That's why people took to those measures, right? And I would say on the East Coast, I mean, if there is a takeaway lesson, I mean, I think it's, you know, a larger kind of takeaway lesson that all communities have to take, which is that, you know, when it comes to this, and it was mentioned earlier as well, right, these programs don't just come overnight and given by the administration. You know, it has to be fought for.
And the final question goes to our distinguished Professor Tang.
I'm embarrassed. Actually, Corky is trying to fight with me over the phone. I mean, not the phone, the microphone. I'm thinking about your question, the question that you pose. What is it that the younger generation want? And actually, for me, coming here is really meaningful for me because I actually taught one of my first Asian American Studies courses at SUNY Buffalo and also at Hunter College. I started in the early 1990s. But the question I actually want to ask is for those of you who have been doing this work for many, many decades, you are still here. And there are a lot of young people here. My students are here. And one of the things that I always tell them is we really need to take it as our responsibility to come to these conferences. These conferences, many years ago, decades ago, they were really, really precious. Now there are all these different kinds of professional annual meetings, associations. But one of the things that I noticed today is there are many of you who have been doing this work for many, many decades. And my question is, why are you still here? Why are you still doing so committed to Asian American studies? And is there anything specific that you would like to say to those of us who are now faculty, who are now staff, who are now students, who are taking these Asian American Studies classes? Is there something that you would like us to be thinking about and remembering from this conference?
I would like to say, have a sense of humor. Enjoy what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And live every day like you're in the world that you're trying to create.
I think my parents really taught me to work hard. When I was very young, my mother told me that my fortune was that I would work very, very hard all my life. And I think that was so that I would never complain because that was my fate. However, she did not say that I would not enjoy my life, that I would not be productive. She did not say that I would not make money, that I would not have influence. But if I were to say what keeps me advocating, because I'm not an Asian American scholar, I have a legal background, I did community work, and I've always been an advocate in some form or another. What keeps me going is that I cannot believe that all of the hard work, the suffering, the investment that my great-grandfather, my grandfather, and my father and mother put into this life should go to waste. I really feel a duty to make their lives worthwhile. That's the reason I do it. And I hope my children will dedicate themselves to the causes that they care about, because then my life will have been worthwhile.
Corky Lee, who hides behind the camera, but he really is a major activist and scholar, and he's curated that wonderful exhibit outside. Please take a look at it one more time before you go. So, all right, you got the last word. Keep it very short.
I am not a scholar, and I basically try to use the camera to bring about fundamental changes one photograph at a time. But what I wanted to announce is on Saturday in Chinatown, 21 Pell Street, Chinese Baptist Church, First Chinese Baptist Church, rather, there is an exhibit on the Chinese Exclusion Act. It's been 134 years since that dastardly deed was done to Chinese. And you can come take a look at the exhibit if you're not really familiar with it. On my own dime, I rented it from California. But at the same time, we're going to have a White House petition to try to get President Obama to apologize officially with an executive order for the Chinese Exclusion Act. Now, there is actually a historical precedent for something like this. In 1993, President Clinton apologized for the takeover of Hawaii 100 years, you know, after that had taken place. So this is probably the last best chance for this current president to apologize after 134 years. And I don't know why the Chinese have to wait 34 more years, but next year it will be 135. So we need 100,000 signatures. So you can come down to Chinatown between 11 and 5 p.m. We're going to have a laptop there and you can sign on. And by the way, you don't have to be a citizen to sign the petition. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
All right, so I guess that's the end of the program. Russell, you want the last word or?
Nope.
Okay, so thanks again to the AARI and to Joyce and Russell and everybody. And thank you all for coming. And now the work continues through your efforts. Thank you very much.